Talk to us a little bit about this community. This is a very small place. It seems like it would be hard to overstate the impact of 25 people dying in a community of just a few hundred.
Yeah, this is a rural part of Texas. It's a conservative part of Texas culturally. It's a small town, less than 400 people. Many of the folks there, I would imagine, are native to Wilson County, Texas, but it's also some people that are from San Antonio or Austin or the surrounding cities who have moved away to get away from the hustle and bustle of the big cities and really have a quiet life and existence there. So, of course, a mass murder is a big deal anywhere, but even any kind of serious crime, other crime, would be a big deal in a small town like this. You know, these towns around that area, this is a neighboring county to San Antonio or Bexar County. You know, they're known for their fall festivals and cultural events. You've got the Luling Watermelon Thump and the Floresville Peanut Festival and the Poteet Strawberry Festival. So these are very tight-knit communities.
And of course, this we are still learning about exactly what brought this gunman to this particular town. He was not from this town, but rather from a few counties over. Can you kind of explain for our viewers, since you're familiar with the area, how far away is Coppell County from where this shooting took place? How long does it take to drive there? Is it likely that he would have had ties there?
Comal County is slightly northeast of San Antonio, up I-35 on the way to Austin, Texas, and Wilson County is a little bit southeast of San Antonio, sandwiched between two major highways, I-35 and I-37. So I would imagine that it would have probably taken him maybe between 45 minutes and an hour to get there, depending on where he lived in Comal County. And, you know, it's such a tragedy because Texas, three generations of Texas have been haunted by mass murder. In 1966, we had the UT Tower shooting. When I was a senior in high school in 1991, we had what at that time was the largest mass murder in U.S. history, which was the shooting in Killeen, Texas at Luby's. And now this generation has experienced this in Sutherland Springs in Wilson County, where 26 people have died.
One thing, Congressman, that has stuck out to me as I've covered this throughout the course of the day, and you saw a little bit of this in the second of President Obama's tweets, this idea that thoughts and prayers are no longer enough and that concrete action must be taken. You've been a member of the House. You've seen some of these debates unfold. We have spent the last several weeks covering, it seems like, tragedy after tragedy. There was the shooting in Las Vegas. There was what happened in New York when a man used a pickup truck to run over pedestrians along the West Side Highway. The responses to both of those are different. And yet it seems when it comes to a gun crime like this one, the response seems to be there's a conversation in Congress and then nothing changes, even if there is widespread support for example, background checks in the wake of Newtown. Do you think that it will be different this time?
I hope so. Unfortunately, Casey, we're gripped by this idea that first, that the Second Amendment is absolute, and also by the NRA's subtle argument that puts us into this false choice, this binary choice, where if you're going to pass a gun law, it has to make sure that it prevents every gun death. And if it doesn't prevent every gun death, then we shouldn't pass any law. The fact is, there are really two strategies here that we need to take on. First, we need to do everything that we can for prevention. So that means supporting background check legislation, and Americans overwhelmingly support that, but also doing what some Republicans have talked about doing, even though they're not doing it now, which is increased support for mental health funding. Their proposed budget slashes mental health funding. Doing away with the ACA would hurt mental health funding. So there's the prevention part, but the other part of it is we have to face the fact that when we look at these massacres, there have been folks who have legally purchased guns and then gone out and killed many people. So even if you put the prevention measures in place, there's still going to be some people who legally get guns and go on and kill people. That's why you have to do something to limit the damage of these firearms. So that's where you get into either an assault rifle ban or limiting the number of bullets in a cartridge. So it's both of these two things that we've got to work on in Congress.
Hey there, I'm Chris Hayes from MSNBC. Thanks for watching MSNBC on YouTube. If you want to keep up to date with the videos we're putting out, you can click subscribe just below me or click over on this list to see lots of other great videos.